Because of his prominence in the defense of the Bab's cause, Baha’u’llah was arrested. Protected, in some measure, by an impressive personal reputation and the social position of his family, as well as by Western embassies who protested the Babi pogroms, he was not sentenced to death. On foot and in chains, with bared head and bare feet, stripped of his outer garments, ridiculed and pelted with stones on the way, Baha’u’llah was dragged through the streets of Tehran and thrown into the Siyah Chal, a subterranean dungeon which had served as a reservoir for one of the public baths of the capital. Wrapped in the Stygian gloom of the Siyah Chal, weighed down with chains, surrounded by criminals, painfully aware of the distress that had overtaken the Bab's followers, at so critical an hour and under such appalling circumstances, a most profound event occurred. Just as Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad had received the irresistible intimations of their divine station through the burning bush, the dove, and the angel Gabriel, that same spirit descended upon Baha’u’llah in the agony and despair of the Siyah Chal, revealing itself in the person of a maiden to his tormented soul. Baha’u’llah recalls the words of solace and encouragement that first informed him of his divine calling.
Verily, we shall render thee victorious by thyself and by thy pen. Grieve thou not for that which hath befallen thee, neither be thou afraid, for thou art in safety. Ere long will God raise up the treasures of the earth, men who will aid thee through thyself and through thy name, wherewith God hath revived the hearts of such as have recognized him.
In his own memorable words, Baha’u’llah describes the impact of the onrushing force of the divine summons upon his entire being. During the days I lay in the prison of Tehran, though the galling weight of the chains and the stench-filled air allowed me but little sleep, still, in those infrequent moments of slumber, I felt as if something flowed from the crown of my head over my breast, even as a mighty torrent that precipitated itself upon the earth from the summit of a lofty mountain. Every limb of my body would, as a result, be set afire. At such moments, my tongue recited what no man could bear to hear. The first intimation of his station that Baha’u’llah received was not immediately disclosed to either his companions or his own family. A period of no less than 10 years elapsed before its far-reaching implications were directly divulged to even those who had been intimately associated with him. This was a period of great spiritual ferment, during which Baha’u’llah restlessly anticipated the hour when he would reveal that the Bab's promise had already been fulfilled, and that he himself was the one who had been chosen to redeem it. Baha’u’llah's imprisonment on August 15th, 1852, in the Siyah Chal of Tehran, lasted for a period of 4 months. Still without trial or recourse, he was released from his confinement and banished a month later to Baghdad, on the first stage of a lifelong exile that would carry him as far as Constantinople and Adrianople and end with 24 years of cruel and unjust incarceration in the prison city of Akka. In Baghdad, the capital city of what was then the Turkish province of Iraq, Baha'u'llah gave priority to the needs of the Babi community which gathered there. The death of the Bab and the loss of most of his notable supporters had left the body of believers scattered and demoralized. When Baha'u'llah's efforts to rally those who had fled to Iraq aroused jealousy and dissension, he followed the path that had been taken by all the messengers of God gone before him, and withdrew to the wilderness, choosing for the purpose the mountains of Kurdistan. During most of this period, Baha'u'llah lived alone in the mountains. For a brief time, he found solace among the admiring populace of Sulaymaniyya. He also achieved fame and great respect among the scholars of several renowned religious orders located in the region. Eventually, acceding to urgent messages from the remnant of the desperate group of exiles in Baghdad who had discovered his whereabouts and appealed to him to again assume the leadership of their community, Baha'u'llah finally returned to Baghdad. A renewed Babi community slowly took shape under the guidance of Baha'u'llah, who still assumed the role of a disciple of the Bab. During this period, there was a flood of Persian Babis whose sole object was to attain the presence of Baha'u'llah. Visitors poured through his open doors, and on returning to Persia, testified to his charismatic leadership and his awe-inspiring presence. O son of being, love me, that I may love thee. If thou lovest me not, my love can in no wise reach thee. Know this, O servant. O son of man, sorrow not, save that thou art far from us. Rejoice not, save that thou art drawing near and returning unto us. Two of the most important volumes of Baha'u'llah's writings date from this period. The Hidden Words, which reveals the heart of Baha'u'llah's ethical message, written in verses which distill the spiritual guidance of all the revelations of the past, and the Kitab-i Khan, a book of over 200 pages revealed in the amazingly brief period of 2 days and 2 nights. With irresistible eloquence, it sweeps away the age-old barriers that have separated the great religions of the world and lays down an unassailable foundation for their complete reconciliation. The undeniable evidence of Baha'u'llah's rising prestige could not fail to fan into flame the animosity of his enemies. Resident as he was on the doorstep of the strongholds of Shia Islam, in direct and almost daily contact with Muslim pilgrims who thronged the holy shrines nearby, a trial of strength between Baha'u'llah and the embattled forces of Islamic fanaticism could not be averted. Months of unremitting scheming by his enemies finally yielded their fruit. On March 26, 1863, a letter from Ali Pasha, the Prime Minister of the Sultan, was delivered to Baha'u'llah, banishing him to Constantinople on the grounds that his continued presence in Baghdad, adjacent to Persian territory and close to so important a center of Shia pilgrimage, was a menace to the security of Persia and its government. The Ottoman government offered him a sum of money for the trip and a mounted escort for his protection. Baha’u’llah declined the money offered him. But when informed that such a refusal would offend the authorities, he reluctantly accepted the generous allowance, but distributed it that same day among the poor. For a period of 12 days before his final departure from Baghdad on May 3, 1863, Baha’u’llah stayed in the beautiful Najibiyah Garden, later celebrated as the Garden of Ridvan, the Garden of Paradise. There, his friends and many notables from the region came to say goodbye and to express their deep sorrow at the departure of so revered a personage. During those days, Baha’u’llah declared his mission for the first time to his immediate followers. This public announcement was a prelude to the broader proclamation of his mission to the world and its rulers from Adrianople, another place of exile on the northern frontiers of European Turkey. No less than 10 years had elapsed between the intimation of Baha’u’llah's station in the Siyah Chal, the Black Pit of Tehran, and the solemn act of his declaration in the Garden of Ridvan in the outskirts of Baghdad. The promise of the Bab, who heralded the advent of He Whom God Shall Make Manifest, was now fulfilled. On May 3, 1863, Baha’u’llah departed from the Garden of Ridvan in the outskirts of Baghdad to the lamentations of the adoring populace, on an arduous 3-month journey to Constantinople, the capital of the Ottoman Empire. Fearing that the developments in Baghdad would be repeated, arousing the sympathy and perhaps even the allegiance of influential figures in the Turkish government, the Persian ambassador, Mirza Hussein Khan, pressed insistently for the dispatch of the exiles to an even more remote part of the empire. As a result of his machinations, an edict was finally issued by Ali Pasha, the prime minister of the Sultan, banishing Baha’u’llah still further to Adrianople, modern-day Edirne. While in Adrianople, Baha’u’llah made his clarion proclamation to the kings and rulers of the world in the form of a series of statements that are among the most remarkable documents in religious history. In his Surah of the Kings, addressed to the kings and rulers of the world collectively, he announces the dawning of the Day of God, alludes to the as yet inconceivable changes which were gathering momentum throughout the world, and calls on them, as the trustees of God and of their subjects, to arise and serve the process of the unification of the human race. The unprecedented outpourings of revelation during this period and after also included epistles addressed directly to individual kings and rulers of both the East and the West, Napoleon III of France, Tsar Alexander II of Russia, Queen Victoria of England, Kaiser Wilhelm I of Germany, Emperor Francis Joseph of Austria, Abdul Aziz, Sultan of the Ottoman Empire, and Naziruddin Shah of Persia. He also summoned in separate tablets the rulers of the Americas, the elected representatives of the people, and the world's religious leaders, including Pope Pius IX. Baha'u'llah addressed the monarchs of his day in unmistakable language of power and authority. Because of the absolute nature of the rule which most of the monarchs of the time exercised, it lay in their power, Baha'u'llah said, to assist in bringing about what he called the Most Great Peace, a world order characterized by unity and animated by divine justice. The vision of the Most Great Peace evoked no response from the rulers of the 19th century. Nationalistic aggrandizement and imperial expansion was the primary motivation of the rulers of the West. Proposals for social change quickly fell captive to a swarm of new ideologies thrown up by the rising tide of dogmatic materialism. In the Orient, mesmerized by its own claims to represent all that humanity ever could or would know of God and truth, the Islamic world sank steadily deeper into ignorance and lethargy. This most glorious period in Baha'u'llah's ministry was drawing to a close. The revelation of so many new and important tablets had endowed the faith with such ascendancy that by the summer of 1868, the authorities in Constantinople had become apprehensive of its rising prestige. The Persian ambassador again induced the Ottoman government to remove the author of that dynamic faith from Adrianople and sentence him to solitary confinement in a far-off prison, a confinement they hoped he would not survive.